Hello everyone. Today we're going to be talking about the EQ sections on Fender guitar amps. Now specifically I'm going to be referring to the Tweed era, the Brownface era, the Blackface era, and the Silverface era of Fender amps. Now the EQ on these amps are subtractive EQ. Now, this is something that people that have owned these amps for many years don't often understand. What this means is that if you turn all the treble, the bass knob, mid knob if it has one, if you turn it up to 10, then essentially the amp is flat. Now that's not entirely true, and it's a little misleading because a guitar amplifier is never completely flat. The speaker colors it a lot, so if you actually had a truly flat signal, it would probably sound horrible to your ears. But as far as the EQ on the amp is concerned, that is its most flat position. So from there, as you're turning the bass and treble knobs down, you're actually cutting those frequencies. There's a certain amount of Fender amps that didn't actually have a mid knob on them. You know, the Princetons and the Deluxes and certainly a lot of the Tweeds. And on these amps, the mid knob was kind of preset at 8. So just straight up, they imagine like there was a mid knob and it was on 8. Now let's talk about how these knobs interact with each other a little bit. So let's say they're all on 10. So you would have your bass and treble on 10, your mid would be preset on 8 if we're talking about a Princeton reverb, for example. As we cut back the bass and treble knobs, we're going to be allowing those mids to pop through because remember, the mid is going to stay at 8. So every time we knock it back, we're allowing more room for the mid-range. And the more we turn up the bass and the treble, that we're kind of keeping the mid where it's at. Now, this is a great thing to remember when you're plugging various guitars in and you're messing around with different volumes on the guitar amp, because these are all like elements that affect one another. So here's an example of how they affect each other. Obviously, we know that as we turn the volume up, the amp overdrives a little more. And so if we think about the bass and treble knob, these may excite the overdrive in a particular way, either one that you like or you don't like. So you can use those knobs to kind of either like get the high end to kind of sizzle in a way that maybe is really interesting with where you have the volume knob cranking at, or to take away a little bit if it's a little bitey. But it's worth mentioning, though, that even if you have like the volume at, let's just say 3 as an example, which I had the volume in the examples I'm going to play for you. I just kept it at 3 the whole time. And if we have the treble and the bass at 3, and then we move it at each of the treble and the bass up to 6, it's not the same sound, right? Even though they're moving up in the same increments. This seems probably pretty logical to a lot of people. But we take it for granted sometimes because as we're playing, we just kind of throw things in the middle and think like, well, that's the middle zone or that's the best spot for it. When I'm recording sometimes and trying to get a great sound of an amp before I plug any pedals or anything in, I'll spend some time with the amp and just kind of get a sound groove in, you know, how overdriven do I want it, and I'll really kind of push each of those treble and bass knobs to see like how it's reacting in the room and with the microphone. It's worth noting that sometimes, because of the way that the frequencies excite the sound, it might be worth like really cranking the high end or low end. And it might be coming out of the guitar amp and sounding a little harsh, but when you throw a microphone in it and then maybe use a console EQ or something to tame the highs a little bit, something magical kind of happens that wouldn't happen if you recorded a duller sound and add the EQ later. This is just due to the inner workings of the amplifier and the tubes overdriving and what frequencies are getting overdriven. But all these little minute details add up when you're trying to really capture an amazing guitar tone. Another thing worth mentioning is you'll notice on tube amps, as you crank the volume up and they start getting distortion, which is very desirable, you'll notice that if the bass is too high, it happens to get a little flabby and tubby. And obviously the best way to deal with this is to turn it down. And some people using Marshalls or Fenders, which both operate on a very similar concept with the subtractive EQ, they'll turn a lot of the tone knobs up all the way and then just really pull back the bass so those bass frequencies aren't getting flabby. Not all amps operate in the same manner, so it's good to spend some time and figure out how your amp works. For instance, like Marshall and Fender work with the subtractive EQ philosophy, but Fender amps have a little bit of a different concept when they're dealing with the EQ section of their amps. So you find that if you go to plug in through a Vox, like those same principles aren't going to apply. So it's always good to note, like if you're, you know, maybe you're playing through a Mesa Boogie or you have some other sort of amp, not to just assume that it's running with the same sort of circuitry. Let's listen to the examples. The amp I was using is a Headstrong Little King Reverb, which is an exact replication of a 1964 Blackface Princeton. The only difference being that I had a 12-inch speaker put into it rather than 10, because I prefer that. The guitar was an American Standard Stratocaster, fully stock in the neck position, and I was only using a cable straight into the amp. The only other variance between the two examples is example one used reverb that was built into the amplifier, and I used a guitar pick, and example number two was no reverb, and I used my fingers. Next time you're working on getting a great guitar sound, spend a little time in the room with just the guitar and the amplifier and see how their relationship is together. Mess around with it. Mess around with the volume knob on the guitar and the tone knob on the guitar. Mess around with all the tone knobs on the amp and the volume knob and just see how they all interact together, because it is a bit of a puzzle, and small adjustments to each of those will create big variances.